Hi, I'm Norman Walburger. Today, let's begin talking about Einstein's special theory of relativity. This is a subject, one of the main accomplishments of 20th century physics, that intrigues many people, old and young. And we're going to see that rational trigonometry ideas naturally allow us to formulate and understand this subject in a perhaps new and novel way. That's going to take us a while to develop. And the stepping stone is we're going to introduce it here, and then we're going to talk about red geometry, which is really relativistic geometry, in a two-dimensional setting in subsequent videos. So in the 20th century, modern physics had really three great revolutions associated, all of them, with the name of Einstein. In 1905, Einstein's special theory of relativity. In 1916, the general theory of relativity, which dealt with gravitation. And in the 1930s, and previously also, the development of quantum mechanics. All of these theories are remarkable, they're non-intuitive, and they're very interesting. We're going to talk about the special theory of relativity today. And in 1908, Hermann Minkowski, who was a mathematician, reinterpreted Einstein's work in terms of a four-dimensional space-time. So he said that we should think about what Einstein's doing in terms of three-dimensional space with coordinates x, y, z, together with time as a fourth dimension, but we should think of these things as being all part of a single whole. We should not separate the space and the time, but rather think in terms of this four-dimensional space-time. And in that space-time, this quadratic form that Einstein used over and over again, x squared plus y squared plus z squared minus t squared, plays the role of quadrants in ordinary three-dimensional space. Now, one thing that's really different about this one is this negative sign here, which means that this quadrants can sometimes be negative, which means that ordinary geometry, based on distance and angle, has a very difficult time establishing itself in this framework. That's one of the impediments for special relativity having been adopted by mathematicians. And in fact, the geometry of special relativity has been sadly underdeveloped in the 100 years since Einstein and Minkowski's work. Although Einstein originally was a little bit skeptical about Minkowski's interpretation, he subsequently grew to appreciate it. And in fact, the general theory, which he introduced 10 years later, relies very heavily on this four-dimensional space-time point of view. So to make some initial contact with the ideas of Einstein, let's ask two questions. What do we mean by here, and what do we mean by now? These are words that are commonly used by us, but in fact, if you try to understand what they mean in a very large-scale setting, there's some problems with it. For example, suppose that I say, let's talk about this point right here, call that here. That point right there. Well, that may be a stationary point as far as we're concerned. But in fact, the Earth itself is actually spinning around once every 24 hours. So what seems to be stationary to us relative to the Earth is in fact to an outside observer moving quite dramatically, spinning around. And moreover, the Earth is rotating around the Sun once a year, and the Sun and the solar system is itself moving through the galaxy, and the galaxy is no doubt moving with respect to other galaxies. So altogether, the actual movement of this here is very difficult to describe. In fact, there's no real good way of ascribing here in the space in which we live. There's no coordinate framework to pin things down about where things actually are. That's pretty clear. That goes back to Newtonian ideas. What's not so easy to understand is that the notion of now is equally problematic. You might say, well, if we have two different people in different parts of the world, they can surely adjust their times, their clocks, so that they're reading the same. But if you inquire as to how you're going to synchronize clocks, then probably you're going to use something like a light signal or electromagnetic signal to convey a common starting point to various clocks around the world. And the trouble is that that light has a certain speed. It takes a certain amount of time to get from here to the other side of the world. So there's going to be a little bit of a lag between your clock starting here and the other person's clock on the other side of the world starting. And if the two observers are separated by a bigger distance, for example, if one is on one side of the galaxy and the other on the other side, then it's completely unclear as to how to coordinate or synchronize those clocks. To simplify this kind of discussion, it's profitable to think about a two-dimensional space-time, which means we're only going to think about space as occurring in one dimension. The other dimension will then be time. So we'll suppose that our world is restricted to a narrow highway, which is essentially one-dimensional. And let's suppose that we have two observers. Here's an observer A in a rocket ship, say, and he's moving this way here, and this observer has a frame of reference, so he can, a coordinate system that he's carrying along with him. And over here is an observer B, and she may be moving in this direction. Also, she's carrying her coordinate system. And they both have clocks by which they measure times. Now, these two clocks here are unsynchronized. And they're moving with different speeds relative to us, the observer, where we're thinking of this tree as stationary. So in fact, there are actually three observers. There's A, there's B, and there's us. Let's call it C. Now suppose we consider an event. Suppose that there's an apple on this tree and it falls and boom, it hits the ground. So that's an event. That apple hitting the ground is called an event. And it's interesting to ask, well, how do A and B observers measure when and where that event happened? The event A is going to be measured by observer A. He's going to say, well, that happened at a certain position called X sub A and at a certain time, T sub A. While the observer B, she's going to say, no, I observe it happening at a different position and at a different time. Now, if you know the relative velocities of these, you can write down what you think are the transformations or the relations between how A measures things and how B measures things. This was essentially done by Galileo a long time ago. And the problem is that Einstein realized that these obvious transformations, which I'm not telling you what they are, between these things are not quite right, that they're only correct if the observers are moving slowly with respect to each other. In fact, the correct transformations between these things are much more subtle. Einstein based his reasoning on a postulate. He supposed that the speed of light was constant for all observers, which were moving with relative velocity with respect to each other. So we may assume that the speed of light is one if we choose our units of length and time correctly. As a consequence of this postulate, Einstein was able to make certain deductions. And amongst those deductions were the true change of coordinates between an observer A's time and position measurements and an observer B's time and position measurements. Now, I'm not going to tell you what they are, except to say that they're so-called Lorentz transformations. We'll talk about these things later on. But the main thing for us right now is to make the observation that Einstein did, that when we transform between A's and B's observations correctly using these Lorentz transformations, then the quantity x squared minus t squared is unchanged. Which means that if we graph these things on an xt plane, then we are moving along a hyperbola like this. This is a hyperbola where x squared minus t squared has a certain particular value. A very unobvious type of transformation. And it suggests that there's a geometry around, that there's a geometry associated to a quadratic form x squared minus t squared. What we're going to do is we're going to think about relativity by starting with this geometry. All right. So we're going to start by understanding a geometry like this using rational trigonometry. And then we're going to come back to special relativity, and with our understanding of this geometry, we're going to be able to simplify a lot of the arguments and explain it in a new way. So next time, we're going to introduce red geometry. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Weilberger. Thanks for listening.